your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Oftentimes, we are holding on so tight to our worries and our burdens, our loved ones. But when we open our hand and release them to God, our eyes are opened to what that God is in control, that we don't have the control anyway. Why are we holding on so tight? And the peace that can come from that for us and for all the people around us sometimes. So, yeah, let's just focus on trusting God as we go through this week and this lifetime. So let's stand and sing together here now. One other thing, sorry. Poinsettia orders. But
there is a sheet for poinsettia orders. You are limited on time this year, so poinsettia orders have to be in today. If you don't have to put the order in, you get money into the church. I'm sure that they'll still put the orders in, but it's very important. And the check today out.
Draw close to you in worship. Speak to our deepest needs. Forgive our sins. Give us new visions for service and accept our fresh commitment for Jesus' sake. Amen.
You are beautiful beyond description.
Majesty.
Morning. I don't see any little ones, but I see lots of big ones. So today I brought a calendar with me. I don't know about you, but I pretty much live by one or two, several calendars. I have bills, or I have a calendar that I put my budget on. I have a calendar that is just for special days, for birthdays and people that I want to remember. And then I just have a calendar for meetings and appointments and all kinds of special days. But most of our calendars come with events that are already on them. So we know that there are obviously Christmas, the 25th of December. It's always on the 25th of December. It may be on a different day, but it's always the 25th of December. We have Easter, we have Passover, we have Hanukkah, we have Daylight Savings, we have Grandparents' Day. We have calendars that have all kinds of special events. But what I'm going to talk about today is an event that there's not a calendar for it. And Jesus was talking with his disciples and said, I am coming back. But scripture says we don't know the time, we don't know the day, we don't know when it's going to be. But the song we just sang, we know how he's coming. You know, he's coming on a cloud and he's coming to take us. But I have my 21 calendar, I have my 22 calendar. There's no time or date on there for that special event. But Jesus tells us to be prepared for that day. And so we need to look into our hearts in terms of how do we prepare for that day that he's coming back for us? Will we be ready? Will we fall into that he's going to scoop us up and take us home with him? So that's what I want to leave with you today, is that though we don't know the time or date, we don't know what it's going to be, we know he's going to come in a blaze of glory. And if we are ready for him, if we are living the life that Christ wants us to live, then he is going to take us with him. There's no question about it, but we have to be ready for his coming. So as we move into being preparing for the holidays and going through Advent and recognizing the birth of our Christ, we also have to recognize that there is going to be a time that he's coming back. So fill your hearts with joy and love and reach out to your neighbor and reach out to the person that you don't know, but know that it is our preparedness for Christ coming to take us home with him that we need to be moving towards. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, you sent us your Son. He gave us everything. He
takes away our sin. He gives us grace. He gives us, there isn't anything that he's not there for us, that you're not there for us. And let us fill our hearts with the preparedness and the waiting, and know that he will come for us in that powerful blaze and take us home to you where we belong. In your son's name, amen.
Didn't warn you ahead of time, but you're good. No, you're good. You're good. This week, we have the blessing of the Christmas boxes. We're sending them out this week, and a lot of people have done a lot of hard work to prepare these. And I don't know if you can see this pile of boxes here, but, or this pile of love, I guess is a better way to put it. Think about all the love that went into these boxes, and think about these little kids that are going to receive these and just know that they're loved in this world, and know that God loves them, and a lot of people love them, people they've never met. And I just want to bless these boxes and pray over them. So would you pray with me, please? Well, Holy God, we thank you so much for the people that have just stepped up, Lord, to love those around them. We ask you to bless the hands that have prepared these boxes, the hands that will receive them and pack them and ship them, and especially the little hands that will receive them. Lord, I please ask you to just bless our world. It's a little troubling place right now, and we need so much love and smiles, and we need your presence and your Holy Spirit sweeping through it. So may these boxes, Lord, be just a smidgen of that as they go out into the world. Thank you for this church, for the love we share, and for all that you're doing with us and through us. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
This is my first time this winter of having to clean my car off in the morning when I got up to or came to church today. So I forgot how long that takes to do. Good morning. our first scripture reading. Let's first pray the prayer of illumination. Help us to see the truth, Lord. And I'm sorry, I thought I heard somebody say something. Help us to see the truth, Lord, and then to apply that truth to our lives. Help us to know you intimately through our prayers and our study of your word, and then help us to boldly stand up for what we know and what we believe. As we witness to your world, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our first scripture is Hebrews 10, 11 through verses 11 through 25, and it's found on 972 or 3 of your pew Bible. Hebrews 10, 11 through 25. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, because by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. First, he says, "This is the covenant I will make with them. And after that time, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds." Then he adds, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more." And where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, But let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Our second lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Mark. It's Mark chapter 13, verses 1 through 13. It's found on page 825 in your pew Bibles, Mark 13. It's titled, The Destruction of the Temple and the Signs of the End Times. As Jesus was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, Look, teacher, what massive stones, what magnificent buildings. Do you see all these great buildings? Replied Jesus. Not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down. As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, Tell us when these things will happen and what will be the sign that they are all about to be fulfilled. Jesus said to them, Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There'll be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever is given you at the time, for it's not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. The sign above the ticket window at the sports stadium in great big bold red letters read, We'll sell you the whole seat for the game, but you're only going to need the edge of it. I like that. It creates anticipation. It promises excitement. Like the fourth quarter of the Michigan-Michigan State game a couple weeks ago. People were certainly excited at that, right? There's excitement and enthusiasm, a sense of hope maybe, or disappointment, but there was certainly expectation. And for some, that's when the pulse starts racing. Your heart begins to thump in your chest. The adrenaline courses through your veins. That's what living on the edge is all about, right? It's exhilarating. For others, though, it feels like it's just too much. Can't live on the edge, they say. It'll kill you. The heart and heightened heart rate, the adrenaline rush constantly, your body will just eventually wear out. Your mind will shut down. Life on the edge is dangerous. And still others are somewhere in between. It's okay to visit the edge periodically. In fact, you should. You can even spend time there occasionally. Small doses, of course, but you can't stay there. After a while, you need to back away, right? Relax. Get more comfortable. Find a sense of peace and security. Wait for things to settle. And you'll do whatever it takes to get there. So where are you? It's an interesting question, don't you think? Where are you? What starts your blood pumping, if anything? March Madness? Michigan? Michigan State? The Lions or Tigers? The Packers? Frankfurt or Benzie? Manchester United? What about tomorrow as we sit here on the eve of St. Venison's Day? How about the holidays, especially after last year? Black Friday sales again after last year. What gets you excited? What manifests anticipation? Thinking about the future, remembering the past. How about taking an honest assessment of what's currently happening in the world? I'm wondering what moves you to the edge of your seat, and I'm asking because Jesus' lesson from Mark is designed to put us on the edge. Watch out, says the Lord. Be on guard. Be alert. Pay attention to what you see. Don't let the Son of Man find you sleeping when he returns. Jesus and the disciples are coming out of the great temple, and the atmosphere is one of anticipation, excitement, expectation. The faithful have been watching and waiting for the coming of Messiah for a very long time. The prophets repeatedly have predicted that he would come. The teachers of the law reminded people time and again to keep watch. And those who waited with their eyes open could see the stage being set. Others were distracted, though, wrapped up in their own daily lives, comfortable, secure. So when Jesus came, they missed it. As they walk along, the disciples are impressed. They're impressed with what they see and impressed with what it stands for. The great temple seems so timeless, safe, and secure. The very bastion of their national identity, built by Solomon, destroyed by the Babylonians in the 6th century BC, rebuilt by Ezra, destroyed by the Babylon, or rebuilt, by, built, they're impressed with the temple. It was built by Solomon. It was destroyed by the Babylonians way back in the 6th century, rebuilt by Ezra, expanded by Herod. They're in awe. Some of the stones in that temple mount were over 15 feet high, 30 feet deep, 60 feet long, and cut from a single slab of limestone. The disciples are impressed with the man-made structures and the man-made institutions. It's pretty clear. But Jesus looks past all of that to the things of God. He talks about how all of this will be gone someday. Jesus actually predicts how the Romans in less than a generation will raise it all to the ground, leaving not one stone standing upon another. And then the Lord goes on to talk about how God will do the same thing with all earthly institutions, with the whole planet even, somewhere further down the line. This entire chapter of Mark's gospel is supposed to make us scoot up to the edge of our seats, raise our pulse. That's the purpose. In the midst of their slumber, Jesus warns them to wake up, telling those who follow him about the signs that'll accompany the end of time. What could possibly be more important than that? Scholars call this section of Mark's gospel Mark's mini apocalypse. The writing is apocalyptic, reminiscent of Daniel or Revelation. The style uses symbols and imagery, sometimes clever and meaningful symbols, sometimes wild imagery, to describe the end of the world. And in doing so, it paints a word picture for us, one designed to put us on the edge of our seats. It's not exactly a fun chapter, though. I mean, who wants to hear about the end of the world? Oh, I get that some people are infatuated with the thought, but there are others who just want to write it off or assign it to the past or distant future or dismiss it completely. And I get that too. But Jesus doesn't stand at either pole. And he doesn't let us do it either. He says, don't let these things frighten you. Don't get all hung up on the future, even when you see these things happening, but keep watch, pay attention. Don't get so complacent with the status quo that you're not living on the edge of your seat. So I'm curious, are you living on the edge of your seat? I mean, if not, what would move you there? What would build the drama for you? Maybe you're one who stays there all the time in constant state of expectation, or maybe you're one who avoids going there at all. But what would it take to get you just a little bit more excited? You know, cause a little enthusiasm. I mean, did you move forward some as we read today's text? Because that was the Lord's intention. Today's lesson comes at an interesting time in Jesus's ministry. At a telling time, really. Just prior to this, Jesus curses a fig tree for not producing fruit. That tree's symbolic of the temple, of course, and the so-called religious people of that day who likewise were not producing fruit. But then Jesus goes on to turn over the tables of the money exchangers, again, critiquing what worship has become. He then warns us that a lot of bad things are going to come our way. Nature will stand on its ears. Folks around you will turn against you. People will persecute you for your faith. Lots of false teachers will come on the stage saying whatever it is that people want to hear. And you need to pay attention to all of this and stand firm in your faith. Don't freak out, he says, but don't get complacent either. Just do the things that I've called you to do. Be the people that I've called you to be. Witness to the truth. Point to me with all that you say and do, and everything will work out just the way it should. So let me ask you, are you like the disciples, impressed with the man-made systems and structures around you? Are you feeling safe and at peace? Are you happy with the trajectory of the world, our country, the church? Are you currently a bit nervous, anxious, maybe concerned? Because I'm really trying to get you to move forward just a little bit. Thursday was Veterans Day, right? And I have a special place in my heart for those in the military and their families. So wars and rumors of wars get my attention. You know, nation rising against nation like Jesus predicts. Did you by chance notice Iran's drone strike the other day trying to take out Iraq's prime minister? Or hear the State Department officials say that it was Iran who attacked that U.S. base in Syria? Did you read the New York Times article back in September that said, and I quote, Iran is within 1 month of accumulating enough nuclear material for a warhead? Did you sit up in your seat a bit when you heard on Friday that Russia is amassing troops and tank battalions on the Ukrainian border, threatening to start World War III? Or when China flew over 150 planes over Taiwan, threatening the very same thing? Did you know that China has had 20 nuclear missile silos for decades now? But currently they're constructing over 200 more. Did it make you jump when they caught the West totally flat-footed recently, testing a brand new hypersonic intercontinental ballistic missile capable of hitting any target anywhere in the world? Or last week when the government warned their citizens to, quote, stock up on food and staples in order to be prepared? Talk about wars and rumors of wars. But what excites you? Earthquakes, maybe, in various places. 14,455 so far this year, all above 4.0 on the Richter scale. 13,652 last year, 12,981 in 2019. The numbers just keep growing, sort of like, I don't know, birth pains. How about famine? The United Nations News Service reported that, quote, 41 million people in 43 countries are teetering on the very edge of famine, up from 27 million just 2 years ago. They also added that currently in Afghanistan, over half the population is facing hunger issues. Jesus mentions people of faith being persecuted because of their faith. According to Open Door USA, quote, "It may be surprising, but Christian persecution around the world is one of the biggest human rights issues of this era. Over 340 million Christians currently reside in places that experience high levels of persecution and discrimination." A speech to the United Nations Human Rights Council in May of 2013 reported that, quote, "More than 100,000 Christians are violently killed because of their faith every year." A December 2016 report stated that between 2005 and 2015, there were over 900,000 Christian martyrs worldwide. And about that part that Jesus talks about, you know, the gospel being preached throughout the entire world prior to the end. Well, according to Wikipedia, quote, "The full Bible has been translated into 704 languages, the New Testament into an additional 1,551 languages, with excerpts from the Bible and Bible stories into another 1,160 languages. Which means that portions of the Bible now exist in 3,415 different languages, what another website estimates to be 98% of the population. I'm not trying to be melodramatic. Well, maybe a little. But I am trying to get you to scoot to the edge of your seat. You're in the game. The big game, the game of your life. And hopefully you're playing your heart out, not just watching. But ask yourself, if you're sitting on the edge of your seat, seeing every single play, cheering as the ball approaches the goal line, or if you're watching casually, only looking up every now and then and only between hot dogs, or if you're slumped over in your seat, scrunched all the way to the back, totally distracted by Candy Crush or Facebook or something else on your iPhone, because the game is being played. Look, Jesus, look at these magnificent buildings. Look, Jesus, just look at what man can do. Aren't we amazing? Are you on the edge of your seat yet? Because I got one last try. According to the Quran, the holy book of Islam, and the Hadith, their holy writings, the end of time will take place, quote, "when a great Muslim nation is established, a caliphate." Think ISIS, the Islamic State in Syria, or ISIL, the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. Quote, "at that time, the blood will be knee high," it says, not as deep as a horse's bridle as it's described in Revelation, but pretty close. And it goes on, "and Yeshua, the son of Mary," it says, "will come on the clouds and fight alongside the caliphate against the Antichrist or Dajjal, converting everyone to Islam." So what if you knew? What if you saw it coming? What would you do? What would you not do? What would you do differently? Would tidying up all those loose ends at work still have the same priority? Would finishing all those projects at home? What would you change? How about reconciling that fractured relationship with a friend? What about finding a way to touch a child's heart or to leave a mark on the world? Would you pray more? Would you go to church more? Would you become more generous? Would you live better and love more? Do you think that you would take the time to draw closer to the Lord and to each other in the Lord's name? And I wonder, because should it take the threat of the end of the world to make you focus on what's really important? Keep watch, says the Lord. Don't let the Son of Man find you sleeping when he returns. You'll know the season if you pay attention. So look around. What do you see? Let me be clear. These signs are not warnings to go buy fire insurance or to go buy hellfire insurance. The point that Jesus is trying to make is for all believers to watch, to be prepared, to persevere in the midst of the struggles that are going to happen. We're called to dig deep and to continue to be enthusiastic and energetic about a faith that will not be popular in the world around us. We're cautioned to keep our faith even in the midst of persecution, even when there's a definite cost. So what does that look like? How do we keep from being that church in Laodicea mentioned in Revelation, the lukewarm, stagnant church that Jesus will spit out of his mouth when he returns? How do we keep from being complacent? How do we truly pay attention and stay alert? Well, I noticed that our reading from Hebrews this morning has a few suggestions. Maybe we should post them on our refrigerator and look at them daily. Draw near to God with sincere hearts and in full assurance of faith. Hold unswervingly to the hope you profess. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. That might bear repeating, especially because of COVID and especially because of our response to COVID. In case you haven't noticed, the church around the world has changed in the last 18 months, including attendance. Lots of folks are finding it far easier to stay at home in their jammies and are no longer meeting together. Draw near to God with sincere hearts and in full assurance of faith. Hold unswervingly to the hope that you profess. Let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. And let us not give up on meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. In other words, live on the edge of your seats, not with your head in the sand. Be a bold and powerful witness to Jesus Christ, even when, or especially when it gets hard. And do it with sincere hearts, both the good times and the bad. And all of God's people said. I invite you to listen for the Holy Spirit nudging your hearts as we stand and sing. Will you please stand?
You alone.
Something that she'd like to share with us today.
I've never done this before, and the Lord's been telling me, Shirley, you get up there. And so here I am. I've been through a lot in my years. I've had a number of a lot of years. But not too long ago, I was reading in my devotion, and it mentioned a hymn, that I've not heard for a long time. I shared this with Sonia. And it says, Jesus is my rock in a troubled world. And I just want to say that through everything I've been through, he's been there for me. And today, he is my rock.
Thank you. Can we pray? Oh, holy God, thank you for being our rock. Thank you for being that firm, solid foundation in the storms and the trouble and the wind and the rain. Thank you for being there in the wonderful times too, Lord, and just smiling and holding out your hands. Be with Shirley today and with this church and with all of us as we step out boldly in your name. We ask this in your son's name. Amen. Each week we come together as a family of God and we share with one another both our joys and our concerns and lift them up before the Lord in prayer. There are a number of prayer requests in the bulletin. I invite you to take these folks with you and to pray for them by name this upcoming week. We have some additions. Kim and Joe Lathwell are still dealing with a lot of unknowns and have a number of upcoming tests and such, so we'd really like to keep them lifted up in prayer. Kathy Bodell asked for prayers for Gary and Nancy Schreimer. They're in the hospital right now. They're friends from downstate. Also, Shirley Mortensen was taken to the hospital on Friday with a potential stroke. We'd like to keep Shirley lifted up. Rick Kemperman has been having some chest pains and has a heart catheterization scheduled for Thursday of this week. The last time he did that, he had 3 stents put in. So let's keep Rick lifted up in our prayers as well. Are there others that we would like to share? Jen.
Meg Bradford and Ron and Barb Subkoviak.
Maggie Bradford and Barb and Ron Subkoviak, traveling mercies. We'll keep you all in our prayers. Thank you. Oh, there's Kathy. Thank you.
A severe case of COVID.
Thank you. We'll keep them lifted up. Angela.
My father-in-law is in the hospital now.
What's his name?
Mark.
Oh, right.
And that whole household has COVID now. Just the whole community check.
For those of you who didn't hear, Mark, Angie's father-in-law, Kamichek, is in the hospital right now. We started praying for him last week. The whole family has COVID, and now Mark has some blood clots. Did I understand that correctly? We'd like to keep him lifted up. Thank you.
Prayers for our neighbor, Rick Reed. He's in the hospital with COVID.
Thank you. We'll keep Rick lifted up too.
Tomorrow's the 15th. Thank you to all the hunters.
Thank you. Tomorrow's the 15th? Thank you, Willie. Thank you. And good luck. Seeing no others, could we be in a spirit of silent prayer, please? Lord, as your people, we're moved by your love and we're quickened by your grace. We're empowered by your hand in our lives and we're blessed by your presence. And for these gifts, we turn to you now in thanks. We're called to you by the voice of your Holy Spirit and gathered together into community in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And for these gifts as well, we praise you now. We exalt you, Lord, and worship you as the very center of our lives. We honor you as our creator and our God. Holy Father, we realize that all that we have and all that we do come to us through you. We acknowledge that as followers of Jesus, we do not make our own way in our journey through this life, but are called to follow your guiding path, eventually reaching the destination that you've laid out for each one of us. Eventually arriving at the place that you've prepared, the very place you wish for us to be. And in knowing this, Lord, and claiming it, we can find rest in your peace. But we also know, Lord, that you've arranged things in such a way that there's power in our asking. You've designed the world so that our prayers and our petitions to you open up the floodgates of your love. You've set things up in such a way that in coming to you on our knees, we actually receive the blessings that you are waiting to bestow. And as such, Father, humbly and on our knees, we come before you now. This morning, Lord, we lift up before you Kim and Joellen Lathwell, Gary and Nancy Schreimer, and Shirley Mortensen. We lift up Rick Kemperman, Maggie Bradford, and Barb and Ron Subkowiak. We lift up the Kamichik family, especially Mark, Lord, and Rick Reed. And we ask you for safety for all the hunters, Lord, that are going out. We also place before you those who are on our prayer list and those who are silently on our hearts even now. And we ask for your blessing and your grace in each of your servants' lives, Lord. We ask for security and health, for comfort and for guidance, and for your power and your presence with each and every one. We place them all, as well as ourselves, before your altar of grace this very moment. And we do this in Jesus' name, praying the very prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. In Luke chapter 14, verses 15 and following, Jesus tells a parable about a man who gave a great banquet and invited all kinds of important people, his friends and such, but they all had excuses. One said he had just bought a field and he has to go deal with it. One said he had bought a yoke of oxen and has to deal with them. The other said, I just got married and I can't make it. The funny thing is, none of those excuses were good enough to not make it to the banquet. The master of the house sent his servants out into the streets to collect the poor and the ruffled and the non non-acceptable by social standards, and he invited them to the banquet. None of the excuses were acceptable to not be at the banquet.
God of grace and mercy, we thank you for this church in which we gather and all the memories it brings to our minds. We realize we're part of a temple not made with hands, and that Jesus Christ is our cornerstone. We're part of a church made not of brick and mortar, but made up of human beings drawn together in Christ's love. Let this bread and wine help us to remember Jesus Christ and to feel him in our midst. As we take the bread and cup, give us strength, courage, and love so that we might truly be the body of Christ here in this church. Amen.
On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." Likewise, after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he gave this to the disciples, and he said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. These things do in remembrance of me." Everyone who believes Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, is welcome at this table. Just come forward, break off a small piece of bread, dip it in the cup, and partake, and gather around the sanctuary for our benediction. And if you're uncomfortable coming forward, please just use the little communion cups in the tray and join us for the circle. And if you're unable to come forward physically, wave us and we'll bring it to you. Come, for all things are now ready. I'd like to remind you that elders are available to talk with you or pray for you after this service. That if today's not convenient, they'd love to hear from you throughout the week. Our benediction comes from a pretty popular section of scripture, 1 Corinthians 13, but I'm going to skip the popular part and do a little before and a little after. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I'm nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardships that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
One in love, one in praise, one in love.